Welcome back, everyone, to the next installment of Gonzo Gamer's Major General Union Campaign with the JMP mod. Let's talk about how I built my army before we head out to First Bull Run. Following the Battle of Philippi, I basically bought $40,000 worth of vets, and then I disbanded all of my units in order to boost the average stats of all the recruits in the pool. Understand that every time you win a battle, you get a fresh batch of recruits placed in the pool, and they drive down the average that I just artificially boosted by disbanding everyone. So in the past, in order to take full advantage of the increased stat boost, I would put 2 career points from Philippi into AO to allow me to have 3 divisions. And then I would build 14 brigades, since you could take 12 to Distress Call, 12 to First Bull Run, and 14 to Logan's Crossroads and River Crossing. Even though 2 units would sit out the first 2 battles, the unit would keep their stats and not be diluted down by incoming recruits. Thus, they would have higher stats than if I waited until after First Bull Run to create them. Now, there's 2 downsides to doing this. First, you have very limited resources after Philippi, so it can be hard to outfit 14 brigades, buy all of your officers, and spend money on vets to boost the pool. Second, it can be tricky to make the game deploy the 12 brigades that you want to use so you can decide which 2 brigades sit out the next 2 battles. Commanders of armies normally determine which of their units deploy, so it's kind of odd sometimes in the game that the AI just randomly decides for you. This campaign is the first time I've disbanded units after both Philippi and Distress Call. Rather than putting 2 points into AO after Philippi, I only put 1 into AO, and I put the other 1 into training. So the 3,200 recruits that I would get after Distress Call, plus any from Prisoner Exchange, would get +2 to every stat. Since there are only about 3,200 of them, they won't pull down the average as much in the recruit pool. So taking as many troops as I could to Distress Call and then disbanding them again, I boosted the pool even more, with the recruit pool now being 32 to efficiency, 34 to morale, 37 to stamina, 38 to firearms, and 29 to melee. Now, we definitely won't be disbanding ever again in this campaign for 2 reasons. One being that the victory at First Bull Run is going to net us 11,700 recruits, plus more from Prisoner Exchange. And that number is just much too large and will drop the average enough that it won't be worth it to try to boost it again. Those average stats will drop by a combined total of nearly 30 points. Second, in the mod, your brigade officers get a battles led bonus. And the bonus looks something like this. With 0 battles led, you have a penalty of -7.5% to command and 7.5% to unit experience gain. With 1 battle led, you are out of the penalty and everything is back to base values. With 2 battles led, you get a +7.5% bonus to command level, officer XP gain, and unit XP gain. And with 3 battles led, you get a 15% bonus to your command level, your officer XP gain, and your unit XP gain. This is the maximum bonus, so getting the 3 battles led is definitely worth it. As long as our brigade officers survive First Bull Run, Logan's Crossroads, and River Crossing, each one of them will have the max bonus going into Shiloh, and given that it's a very large multi-day battle, it is definitely a bonus that will pay dividends when we get there. As far as the camp here leading into First Bull Run, I did the following. I put my 1 career point from Distress Call into Army Organization. I bought Brigadier General John Gibbon with reputation points and gave him 1st Division and put my Avatar in 2nd Division. That gives me 2 Brigadier Generals in each of those divisions. Then I created a 3rd Division and gave it to my highest ranking Colonel, Lewis Wagner, who's likely to be a Brigadier General by the end of First Bull Run. I increased my supply wagon to 20,000. I did not buy any vets this time around. I bought 4 Napoleons to go with my 17 that I already had, so I can create 3 batteries of 7. My batteries will all have 12 guns eventually, but 7 is a good start. I created one battery of 9 ordnance rifles out of the 13 that I have. I left 4 in the armory because I will be converting one of my Napoleons to ordnance in the near future when I get some more weapons, and I don't want to short myself when that time comes. I'll then take the 7 that I take away from that battery of Napoleons and put them into the other 2 groups to boost them up. I created one scouting cav brigade with all carbines that I got from distress call. I created 4 skirmisher brigades and put them in 3rd division, because at first bull run, the AI will deploy all of my 1st and 2nd division, and then it will randomly pull 2 from my 3rd division. And since all of my skirmishers are the same, it won't matter which 2 are selected. I created 5 infantry brigades, one with Springfield 55s, 2 with Mississippis, 1 with Rebors, and 1 with Springfield 42s. And I did buy a few extra 42s for that particular unit. All infantry received an accuracy perk. My guns were all were given improved shells with increased range, and my cav and skirmishers all received perks that increased spotting. Now, it's sort of hard to power level skirmishers, so whichever 2 are not deployed at first pull run probably won't make it to 2 stars. It's going to be hard enough to get the 2 that do deploy to 2 stars. Artillery are definitely the easiest to level. Infantry are not that bad, and cav are just a little bit easier than skirmishers. So in hindsight, it may have been better to do a little bit different setup, but the die has been cast, and we're going ahead for first bull run. My final comment on the camp here. So when I started playing Ultimate General Civil War, my default division arrangement was always 3 infantry brigades and 2 artillery, and then either a cav or a skirmisher unit. And I alternated divisions between cav and skirmishers. Since I've been playing a Major General, I've come to appreciate both cav and skirmishers more, so my default division now will end up being 2 infantry, 2 artillery, a skirmisher, and a cavalry. Alright, we're heading to first bull run. So for those of you that have been following along, you know that I have AI scaling size multiplier set to 1.3. And that gives the enemy 35,972 soldiers here with 76 guns. By comparison, had I left it at the base level, we'd be facing 28,342 and 59 guns. So those additional 7,600 men and 17 guns will give my units more XP and weapons recovery upon successful completion of the battle. In my experience, if you play this battle with AI scaling at 1.5 or greater, you start to have ammo problems even if you steal a couple of supply wagons, and the Allied units can get pretty beat up by the end of the battle because Joe Johnson's units will be pretty big when they come in to counterattack. And those Allied units can just not handle the charges that are coming in. They'll just be decimated by the time you get done. So, you know, if you start playing this on 1.5, 1.6, somewhere in there, you can expect some of your Allied units to be completely gone, if not shattered, by the time they get done. I don't know of anyone that actually engages the enemy at the bridge. Some people there move their forces to the ford north of the bridge. Some people bypass any early combat and move their forces around to join up with the main force. I like to engage at the ford for one main purpose, and that is to try to coax Clay's dracoons to attack and hopefully eliminate them so that when my cav come onto the battlefield, they're free to do some early raiding and recon without being harassed by the enemy cav. Since we got splits on one of the guns and one of the infantry, I'm going to send the extra infantry around to link up with my main body. There is somewhat of a sweet spot here at the ford where our guys can see decently to allow our artillery to soften up the unit on the other side of the bridge. And here come Clay's Dragoons, and it doesn't appear that they have a split unit, so this should be the only cav the Confederates have early on, until Stuart arrives later in the battle. Two of our infantry here have melee perks, so I'd prefer that they be the ones that engage the Dragoons if possible. His ideal outcome would be able to charge through an opening and take out my artillery, so we want to move to be able to avoid that. Alright, he's changed his mind. Once our artillery unlimber and load up, that will counter any charges he tries while we whittle them down, assuming that he keeps coming back for more. I'll increase the game speed here while we're waiting for our main body and the Allied scouting cav to come in. while our units are entering the field and getting set up, we will link up our two KF units and go see what sort of trouble we can get into. Sometimes a lot comes of it, other times not so much. It just depends on what the AI is doing with their units. It's sort of an early sparring and feeling out period. Looks like he has one split gun here. Let's see what they do, and maybe we could take one of them. I see that I forgot to label my guns, so I don't know which ones are the smooth bores and which one's the rifle. I normally do that so I don't have to look at the unit details to figure it out. Just have to remember that the bigger one is the rifles and the other ones are all Napoleons. Two guns are not near the infantry and one of them is limbered, so it'll be a while before they can fire, so we will charge the other one. Clay's dragoons are coming in, so we will need our scouts to possibly engage them. I have about 900 combined cav here, so I like my chances of capturing or forcing them to surrender. Clay's dragoons charged too early and now they've lost their charge bonus, but my scouts still have theirs and my carbines can fire at them point range during the melee. So he shattered.
Come on!
his infantry are moving closer to that artillery brigade, so we may need to wait on that one. So I typically send the supply wagon that comes in with the Allied units over to the Ford. My supply wagon is big enough to feed the main body until I can steal another wagon. For the most part, my units go into the wood line to the right, just north of Matthews Hill, and I had the Allied units come in to the woods to the left. Two of my units will provide backup for the Allied units. I let the Allies try to take the initial wave of the charge that comes in, since my units have accuracy perks, so right now they're much better at shooting than they are melee. We got a split on Wilcox, so that's going to help a bit.
Reload! Find cover!
there's the supply wagon we want. So our KF moving around in the south tends to distract the AI from focusing on our units as they get into place until I'm ready to reveal them. It doesn't always work that way, but more often than not, it does. When possible, I like to get my KF into position so that when the AI starts charging my infantry, my KF can come up and take in some artillery or help clean up the retreating Confederate units when they decide to rout. At the same time, I don't want to trip the VP and cut this phase short too early in the battle. And you do need to keep an eye on the Confederate units that may move into the fortifications on Matthews Hill, because that'll give them long enough range to cover their artillery in most cases. We will start moving forward. The Confederates are not moving off Matthews Hill yet. They will probably charge again. With our double stack, we should beat them pretty good with firing into them during melee, if they make it that far. So Hampton's Legion is shattered, but he is still holding on. With them retreating to Henry Hill, we want to push our units to try and intercept their reinforcements at the river, rather than engaging them after they've crossed, but it depends on the condition of the units, because you definitely don't want to fight when they're tired. This might get a little hairy with Stuart trying to flank my artillery on the ford. Thank you. On the other hand, the skirmishers are welcome to commit suicide at the fort anytime they like. I'll take those 500-yard range weapons all day long. What a cluster. My guys are tired and they have multiple 2-star units charging at them. It's probably going to get ugly. My center is anchored fairly well with the artillery firing. Most of those units are in good condition, but I need to get the flanks under control and get those guys some rest. There's plenty of time to move up to take Henry Hill in this phase, so there's no need to rush. If we can push these guys back to the river, we'll be looking pretty good. Louisiana Tigers are doing their best to be a pain in the butt, so we need to see if we can get them out of here. I admit, I don't always do a good job at keeping my officer close to the battle. That's something that I'm trying to improve on. In my opinion, First Bull Run is really not a fair fight in the game. The Union get all of their units at the start of the battle, whereas the Confederate force is deploying three phases. So if you can destroy most of their units in each phase without triggering an early end of the phase, you can stay ahead of them all the way to the end. However, if you start triggering early ends to phases before you're ready, you can get yourself in a little bit of trouble. You definitely want to have your guys in place on top of Henry Hill before Joe Johnson shows up to start the counterattack. I'm always a bit leery about pushing up to Henry Hill too quickly. The Confederates normally have a few artillery units with skirmishers and an infantry or two in the dark area behind the hill. It can also be a pain if the unit in the fortification has two or three stars. I don't know if this is the best way to set units up for Henry Hill, but this formation normally works for me. Whenever one of my units routes off the front line, I rotate in the unit that is waiting behind them. I hotkey groups of artillery so I can quickly shift fire to manage charges once the counterattack starts. In this particular battle, I have 4 smoothbores grouped on the left, 4 more smoothbores grouped on the right, and my lone ordnance rifle is centrally located and on a separate hotkey. I have 1 unit walk up and take the VP and have them back off, knowing that the AI will hurl units until they take it, and then I just push them out and I do it again. So Wade Scales was just wounded, which is one of the officers you get at the start of the campaign. Of course, in the mod, there is the officer replacement system, so another officer is placed in charge of the unit. If both officers survive the battle, the officer XP is split between the two of them. So one benefit of having a training focus is that training affects the level of the replacement officer. For example, Scales is a higher level colonel. Without any points in training, his replacement might be a high-level major or a low-level lieutenant colonel. With training maxed out, his replacement will be much closer to his actual rank. So while it sucks that one of your good officers is wounded, getting a free officer of similar level helps take some of the sting out of it. that officer that was killed was from the Allied units and not mine. There's a bug in the game that when an Allied officer is wounded, there's a chance that they appear in your barracks, even though they shouldn't. I believe that that will be reviewed in the future if Panda Kraut and Johnny figure out what exactly was causing it. So the AI's initial charges are over, and he's starting to run out of juice. The AI recovers condition much faster than the player, but he's taking a ton of fire here. I will start to deploy more units around the flanks, and then I will push them back and end this. this wasn't as clean as it could have been, but then again, it really turns out that way. But we got quite a few captures here at the end. So I lost about 30% of my army, but most of those were allied units and not my core. We captured almost as many units as we lost. The Confederates had about 75% of their army either killed or captured. We have lots of promotions. Most of our captains jumped up to lieutenant colonels. Wagner made it to brigadier general, so now we have a general in each of our division commander slots. Thanks for watching. I normally play Logan's Crossroads before River Crossing, so I'll see you there next time.